Okay, hi. I've been feeling really stuck. You can't even see me, can you? In terms of making videos, and I remember on my poll a couple weeks ago, somebody had requested a life in the day. I just got a wild hair and decided, well, let's do a life in the day video today. 10 o'clock. My day usually starts at 7-ish, 7:30. Today I went and walked a dog that I walk 3 times a week in the mornings, and then I will be going to pick up Lexi, who, if you've been around, you've seen in some of my other videos, to bring over for some dog sitting in the afternoon. And then in between, I get to do other stuff like. I just went to the grocery store after I walked Hazel. So maybe you can see it over there. Yeah. And now Hazel's dad just texted me about next week. So they'll be out of town on Monday. Am I free on Tuesday or Thursday? Next, I've got to put groceries away. This is what usually Thursday or Fridays look like for me, which is I go walk a dog or two and then stop off at the grocery store and then dog sit in the afternoon and do other things like read and stuff. You know, I did watch the Barbie movie last night and I watched the whole Beef series the night before. Oh, that was so pleasurable. I don't know if you've seen Beef. I think it's little known. I hadn't heard anything about it. It's actually really good. I made split pea soup this week and a lasagna. I have a lot of food to munch on, so I don't need it. I didn't need all that much, but I woke up with a sore throat this morning, so I got myself some elderberry lemon balm tea to slurp on during the day. Got some meat for the dogs. It's not for me. I don't eat meat. I got myself some tofu. Dog treats. And this is getting very uncomfortable. I think that should work better. Let's see. More tofu. Some of this stuff, which you know what's really good? If you spread this on crackers and then put a fresh basil leaf and an olive on top. Oh my God! To die for. Milk, maple syrup, because I've been eating a buckwheat porridge in the mornings, also to die for. It's so good. Maybe I'll leave you the recipe in the description for it if you're looking for. I'm always looking for breakfast food that makes me feel good in the mornings and is filling. And it's really hard for me to find a breakfast food that works. I'm finding that buckwheat porridge actually makes me feel really great after eating it. So if that is a concern of yours, in terms of like how you feel during the day, because I try and eat. You know, there's like a couple factors when choosing stuff to eat. There's the pleasure factor in sort of like the guilty pleasure, like, this is so good, but I know it's like got a ton of sugar in it or a ton of fat or something. You know, which that kind of pleasure is healthy and happy every once in a while. What is going on? Oh, and then there's the actually makes me feel like nourished and like good in the day because these are things that I think about because I often feel bad, and this is something that I think is only, no, it's been happening for a while, and I've been trying to get to the bottom of why I feel so off sometimes, and I think whatever's going on contributes to migraines, it contributes to vertigo, it contributes to just feeling like a sense of you just don't feel good, but there isn't like any real place to pinpoint it. I think it's hormonal probably, but anyway, so I'm always looking for stuff that's going to support me in feeling well so that I have better days, rather than having to sort of like, you know, slog both words through a day and feel like I'm trudging through it. And this week I've already had 2 days like that. And so it's really nice to, when I'm feeling energized and feeling good, like this morning I feel good, yesterday I felt like crap. Then whenever I find these meals, then they help me feel better in general. Another meal that makes me feel that way is there's a Nourish Bowl. I'll also leave a link. It's from the same website as the porridge. And there's just a really simple recipe of brown rice, steamed broccoli, and sauteed tofu. Make the tofu crispy and then sprinkle some tamari or some soy sauce and some sesame oil on everything. And if you want to feel good, that will make you feel good too. It's like a power dish or something, and it's so simple. I'm thinking today might be the day to dip into this, because I don't want to get sick. This might be good for the immune system. It's an elderberry hibiscus honey that I've been letting sit for the last 3 weeks in the window. Marshmallow has mucilage in it, which coats the throat, so I was thinking I might make some marshmallow tea, and then marshmallow is in marshmallow root, not actual, like, confectioner's marshmallows. When you're making a tea with a root or a bark, like something that's a little woodier, then you want to make a decoction rather than an infusion. So I'm just going to throw a little marshmallow root in the water. And then you let it simmer and boil. And then that way you get all of the mucilage and medicinal properties out of it rather than just putting it in a tea bag or, you know, using it as an infusion, because the boiling helps open up the bark. While we're waiting for the tea, the marshmallow root, I guess I thought I'd sit and talk to you. I've been in quite a lull in my motivation to practice and make content, and part of that is figuring out what would make me happier. I've been struggling a lot with, I guess, my mental health, and the things that are kind of like affecting me are, ooh, excuse me. I just had, like, you know, after you drink soda and the carbonation goes up your nose, it was that feeling. I think I am getting sick. I've been feeling really kind of unmotivated and low. And part of it is, it's the state of the world. That's part of it, is just feeling really helpless about all of the things that are happening that are just wrong. I've never understood since I was a kid why war has had to happen. And ultimately, intellectually, I do, you know. What I don't understand is this incessant need for power, for conquering others, you know, hurting others. That has always been something that has been really upsetting to me, and I'm grappling with that right now. The world feels different now than it did several years ago. We've entered a different era, I think. I'm just feeling really uncomfortable in it. It's been affecting my daily life. And one of the things that I've been trying to figure out is, what is that threshold between just enough and too much? One thing that I've done is I've very much minimized my social media input. I'm sort of like detoxing, I think, taking a break from it. And I'm very sensitive. You know, all I have to do is see a headline or a few moments of a clip somewhere, and it's like a rush through my system, and it affects me deeply. It will ruin my day for many days on end. Managing that is a skill that I'm still working on. For a long time, I've known that boundaries have been a really big issue for me. It's something I need to work on, and I've been working on them. I've in the past been a pushover, and as I've retracted from that, I've become super like short and blunt with my boundaries. So it's just like, here it is, you know, and my diplomacy, it can be lacking. That's something I'm figuring out, is how to nicely and eloquently say, hey, I'm uncomfortable with this. I think because of that sort of boundarylessness, I've realized that I can very easily feel the feelings, the perspective of one person or another, and get overwhelmed with intensity, and then bad things come out of me. You know, like this desire to control somebody, what somebody else is doing, which is not okay. But I'm starting to make these connections of like, oh, that person is making me really uncomfortable, so now I gotta figure out how to navigate it. That's sort of one thing that I've been struggling with more recently, and sorry, I was just checking on the tea. Or decoction. So that's something that I've sort of uncovered and realized recently, is that tendency to really be able to take on somebody else's perspective or thing as my own and not stay strong in the neutrality so I can figure out what I feel. That, I think, is an empathic way of being in the world. And doing things like meditating, practices like pulling my awareness back from the world and back into me and grounding, like rooting, helps. These are things that I do to manage how I am and to stay contained and within my own sphere or own knowing. This is supposed to be a life in the day. I suppose it is. I'm just talking. Validation is also something that I have struggled with my whole life, still struggle with it in a big way. The only thing I know about it is that when I seek outside of myself for some kind of love, some kind of validation, like, you're doing okay, that's an unending straw. Like, all I want to do is slurp up that, but it never really satiates the need. It's just like, give me more and more and more. And that is not something I like. And I've done a lot of things to, you know, to get that validation that have been not in alignment with who I am. And that's partly something that I've been struggling with here on my YouTube channels. I like to share, I like to teach, I like to interact, but there's also a part of me that relishes that validation of like, okay, good, I affected somebody well. It's like to prove to myself I'm worthy, I'm good. When I realize I seek validation, then I start feeling bad about myself, feeling like I can't do this, and I want to run and hide. My instinct when I feel vulnerable is to hide and be by myself, and not let anybody in. And that is something that I've been wanting to grapple with better this year. How do I stay focused in what I'm doing, not need the validation, but I'm connected so deeply to that thing that is motivating me inside and that I know is right, rather than trying to fulfill somebody else's expectations of what I should be doing or who I am. The one thing that I really have a hard time combating is this sense of, oh, I am a bad person at the core. It's probably why I'm drawn to priestess work, because it's all about alignment. It's all about alignment and figuring out how to connect to that, being honorable in your word and in your actions, and this is a lot, isn't it? I don't know if this is at all what you guys signed up for. There we go. There's the validation seeking coming out again. It's what I feel like expressing, and and instead of getting like the perfect version of Aurora, or the most perfect that she can deliver, I'm telling you what my foibles are, what my imperfections are, what I'm struggling with, what I'm Wow, this is intense. I don't have a career path per se. I know that sounds weird, but if somebody were to ask me, what do you do for a living? I don't know what to answer. I've been uncomfortable with that question for a really long time, because I do a lot of things. I've done many things. There isn't just one thing that I've done. I suppose when you when you get a degree in theater, your life, it means your life is going to turn in many other directions. I do voiceover. That's one of the things that I have done for a long time in that realm. A lot of the work that I've done in my life has just supported my ability to have sort of the freedom to pursue, when I was younger, an acting career. I don't do that anymore. I do some coaching, which I adore. I love it so much. I walk dogs, pet sit, dog sit, but I have found some inspiration in, I started reading The Bones Fall in a Spiral by Mortellus, and it's really good. It's very specific, and what I want to do is pull out practices from it. It's about necromancy, and I want to pull out some practices from it that I can use, and I can't use all of it. I think there are not a ton of people who could use all of it unless you are very dedicated to, unless you're like Mortellus, which is a mortician who has access to bodies. Anyway, I don't want to get too deeply into it because I'm going to do a review video on the book, but it's been very inspiring to read this book and learn about their practice and figure out what things I might be able to take from what they do and incorporate it into what I do. I just read about their Beltane ritual. It's really beautiful. I'm not gonna continue with this line because you'll see it in a minute. I mean, in a video soon. But that has been a source of new vitality that has come through, is reading this book, which is always nice when you find a book like that that is inspiring to you and makes you want to engage in your practice differently. All right, so I think I'm gonna quit the talking right now and figure out what's next on my plate and then bring you guys along.
Our focus here is on the invocational power of word, that which any priestess must master. Blessed be.
Ah, this is just what I needed to hear for some movement. It gave me an idea. Butter. Avocado, and then spices. Excuse me. Man, I hope I'm not getting sick. This is fresh parsley from a farm box that I get once a month. Get it later. Alright. I gotta get these two girls prepped.
Hold on. Oh, Missy. I can't do that. Alright, my dear. You know where you're going, right?
Yes.
Okay, hold on. Sit down. Sit. Sit. Thank you. Sit. I know. I know. You have to sit. Sit. Sit down. Sit. Thank you. Good job. I know bees. Hold on. Wait a second.
Sun.
Hey, bird.
Are you leaving now?
Probably.
Okay. All right. I'll see you later. Enjoy yourself. No, we're not going in the car. You know that. We don't have your harness on. Okay, so Bertie gets dropped off with my mom because Bertie hates Lexi. No kitties. No kitties, lady. Come on. Keep walking, please. Thank you. Good work. Hey, so there's feathers here from the bird that was killed. The hawks like to hunt here, and then they perch in one of the magnolia trees and pluck them. And, so I'm going to take some of these feathers because I think they could be useful in a necromantic working. So, just doing a little stop. Yeah, you like it, Lex? No, you can't have it. I'm putting it in my bag. No. Thank you, Bird, for your contribution. I don't have any other work that came in today, so I thought I would there's this salve, both ways are right. So I have this recipe for an anti-itch salve for dogs. I think it's for cats too. I'm sure it would work for humans. But I got it from, there's a YouTube channel called Veterinary Secrets with Dr. Jones, and he gives you all kinds of alternative remedies for your pets. And I've picked up some things from him, and this in particular is his recipe for an anti-itch salve. And Birdie licks her feet a lot, and I know that's related to allergies, and probably food related, but sometimes she, you know, licks it so much that she's got like a red rash on her toe pads. So I want to make this anti-itch salve and see if it helps her. It's just melting down some coconut oil, castor oil, sunflower oil, and shea butter, and then beeswax, and that's it. So I have an empty tin that I just finished some calendula salve out of. Where'd I put it? So I'm just gonna use this and refill it with this anti-itch stuff. So I thought I would take you along while I do this. It's pretty easy. I have another video on how to make a calendula salve, which I'll link for you in case you're interested. It's just, you make a double boiler type thing and then add in all your ingredients. And then on a low heat, wait for the beeswax and the coconut oil to melt, and then you just pour it in your container and then wait for it to harden. It's as simple as that. All right, the jar, 2 tablespoons of beeswax, 1/2 tablespoon of shea butter, comes in blocks. That will work. Oh my. Drop that in there. 2 tablespoons of sunflower oil. Great. 1, 2. Okay, and then 2 tablespoons of castor oil. 1, 2. 3 tablespoons of coconut oil. 1, 2, 3. Move on over to our stove. Plop this in. Okay, it's ready. So turn it off. Yay, perfect amount. Done. I just got an inquiry for a voiceover for an AI assistant. I have questions about that. So I sent them off while my salve was hardening. So they want a voice assistant for some kind of application, which is somehow powered by AI, but I don't know what that is. So like, if they're using my voice to train an AI to sound like me, then that is an absolute no-go, because basically what I'm doing is I'm selling my voice to a competitor who can then basically for very cheap utilize it for voice projects. That is not anything any performer in any regard wants to say yes to. I mean, unless you're getting like some kind of residuals or cuts for the rest of your life, basically. So I'm trying to understand what it is that they want, because if it's just me reading a script and then they have some kind of AI using sentences that I have said based on the question that someone's asking, that's a different story. You know, they're not like trying to use my voice and train a computer how to sound like me. It's a completely different thing. So I don't know exactly what their project is. It wasn't super clear, but I just answered with my questions about it. So we'll see what they say and if they get back to me today. I don't know if they will or not. But that is the sometimes the kind of inquiries that we get.
Hey, leave her alone.
When it comes to voiceover work, you have to be really careful about the things that you say yes to, because people will not look out for you. They will take advantage of you. So you have to know what you're sort of like dealing with and getting into when it comes to this kind of stuff. Yeah, I just got a text from Lexi's mom. Let's see, it's 2:30. Found out that it's gonna rain, and it's starting to look like, I feel like it's going to, not in this very second, but it's a little better. Sorry, I'm always looking to the side here to check the monitor, the screen, essentially. And I've got two plants that I have to, they're very picky, they're succulents. This is called baby's toes. The squirrels are munching on them. I don't like that. That's annoying. Squirrels are doing everything down there that is bad. They chewed the flapper off of the wind chime. Pretty sure the wind chime flapper is gone. And this dude right here. I don't know what this is. I can't remember what the name is. We're supposed to water them like once a month. Cleo has been obsessed with this corner and area for about the last half an hour, sniffing and keeping a sharp eye on it. So we have a visitor back.
Dude, this guy, he's a senior. And he was stabbed. He's at the shelter, and they're asking for a rescue to step up and take him because his hind legs are weak, but they all love him. I hope he gets out. This is so frustrating. I just sent a message about him to a rescue that deals with senior dogs mostly, so... They get back to me about half the time. We'll see what they say about him, if they say anything.
So it looks like this potential customer client will not be using my voice for AI training at all, which is good news. It's just for script reading, and they somehow insert it into some AI program to be like a virtual assistant. For this app, I guess. This healthcare app. Okay. Cool. We'll see what they say. We're sort of negotiating. As you can see, I'm kind of fielding lots of different things here. Cleo, is that where the mouse went? Did it go down there? It did? Is that where it's living? Lexi Lou, you want to come up and say hi?
Ugh.
Yeah? You want to turn around and say hi? No, don't lick my face. Don't lick my face. Okay. Yeah? You want to say hi to the camera? Look, people are there. Cleo, you're sticking your face in her butt. So yeah, this is my Friday of this week. My days don't really always look the same. Not really. Always lots of different things happening, but today was kind of more low-key, which is nice. So we'll see how this weekend goes. It's supposed to rain, and which I love, which means candles will be lit and reading will happen and indoor things will happen and coziness will ensue. So I'll see you guys next time. Bye.